Thank you, Bill. Indeed, a time of unprecedented collaboration. It's now my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker. Clayton Christensen is a professor of business administration at the Harvard Business School, where he teaches one of the most popular elective classes, Building and Sustaining a Successful Enterprise. He is regarded as one of the world's top experts in not only innovation, but growth, and his ideas are used widely by organizations around the globe. Clayton has written 9 books, one of which is The Innovator's Prescription, and he has written hundreds of articles. So please help me welcome to the stage Clayton Christensen.
I've seen medicine from almost every conceivable perspective of a patient. And I just want to say thanks to you guys. You're working in an industry that wasn't designed in any way to help you do your work better. It seems to me that it's been structured to make it very hard for you, and despite of that, all of that, you sacrifice your lives for plain old ordinary people like me. So I hope that you will feel my gratitude to you, and that I hope some of my ideas are useful to you as well. Will a miracle occur? I sure hope so. The first chunk of thinking that I'd like to share is around this slide, which is, all of us are trying to improve the way we deliver healthcare. We want higher quality, lower cost, and we're working a jillion things to try to do that. I've decided that if we don't do these two fundamental things, almost everything else we try to do to improve the quality and lower the cost of healthcare will come to naught. These have to be done, and the sooner we get to it, the more successful we'll be on other important things. And I just listed a few of them here. Probably won't have enough time to go through each of these. And then on top of those, there are many more things we can do. But I want to focus at the beginning on those two blue blocks. Getting a business model right, and the visible hand of managerial capitalism. It's funny, but we talk about business models all of the time, but we don't ever think about what is a business model, and how can I know what an organization can and cannot do if I understand what the business model is? A business model is organized with 4 blocks. And the first one is, what's the value proposition we're going to offer to our customers? If we know the value proposition, then we know what kind of resources we have to have, what kind of people we need, what kind of technology, brands, equipment, facilities, and so on that we have to have on hand, so that we can deliver the value proposition. As we use our resources to deliver the value proposition, processes emerge. And almost all processes emerge. Later on, we try to manage them, but at the beginning, just ways of working together that allows us to combine resources to deliver the processes are quite important elements of a business plan. And then lastly, the profit formula. That is, what kind of margins do we need? And how fast do we need to turn our assets over to get the return that our investors require is a very important element of the business model. And the profit formula essentially then determines the kind of value proposition that we can and cannot make. And very quickly, these 4 blocks in a business model become interdependently locked. And it's very hard for you to innovate anything once it's interdependently locked, unless you change everything. And that means a business model has real strengths and weaknesses. The most important insight that we get from this is that if you need to fundamentally change, an organization that has its business model in place is very hard to change. Almost always you have to set up a separate business unit that it can be create a new business model de novo, because the old ones have very hard problems in changing. When I look at healthcare, and especially from the perspective of a hospital, it seems to me that about 100 years ago, the business model was put into place, and there is no other industry in the world that looks like a hospital business model. Because the business model of a hospital is not it's not plausible. It shouldn't exist. So the value proposition that was created 100 years ago was, you know, guys, I don't care what's wrong with you, bring it here. We will solve any problem for any person. And they put that essentially in neon in front of the hospital. Everybody knows that whatever's wrong, you can go there and they'll try to solve it for you. With that value proposition, and nobody else in the world says we can solve everything for anything for anybody, the hospitals have to put together resources so that they can solve any problem for any person. That's very costly and capital intensive, as you know. And so we use these resources to deliver the value proposition, and little by little, processes emerge in a hospital. And most processes just happen, but they happen to allow you to solve any problem for any client or any patient. And as a consequence, it is a very complicated organization. And then the profit formula is, how do we make money when every patient is different? And where the price of the services are really not clear. And really the profit formula is, well, I hope we get more money coming in this year than we send out. But I hope you get a sense that you guys are living in a very different world than the rest of us have had to suffer through. By analog, in my course we have a case. Michigan Manufacturing makes axles for cars and trucks. And there are 9 plants throughout the Midwest that make these axles. And one of them, located in Pontiac, Michigan, was slated to be shut down. The reason, it was too complicated and too costly. And the way they make their profit, or the way they calculate their costs in this business, is they put the costs into 2 buckets, overhead and direct costs. And then they calculate the ratio of how many dollars of overhead you have to have in place to support a dollar of fixed cost. And the most efficient of the 9 plants was in Maysville, Ohio. That ratio was $2.2 of overhead per $1 of direct cost. Very efficient. In Pontiac, Michigan, it was $6.2 of overhead per dollar of direct. And something was just wrong in the plant. But when you looked in the plant, it didn't look like they were wasting money on overhead. And this is the way it looked if you went into the plant in Pontiac, Michigan. It was organized by the type of product, or by type of technology embedded in the machines. because putting the machines together allowed you to optimize the utilization, and the machines cost several hundred thousand dollars a piece. Also, by putting them together by technology, it allowed you to get the very best operators, and they had to be very skilled, and so you could optimize their utilization. But the big driver behind organizing the plant in this way is that it could make any axle for anybody. And the way they did that was the engineers from the client brought the designs for the axle and gave it to the Pontiac engineer, and he'd look at the design, and then he'd plan out a route for the part through the factory. So in this illustration, you'd cut it off to length, and then you'd take it to the turning machines, where they lathed the outside diameter precisely. And then they decide, we'll take it to the hobbing department, where we cut the gears in it. And that makes the steel mad. And so we'll make it sit in an annealing furnace until it gets control of his emotions. And then we'll bore holes in it, and then we'll put the tapping puts the screw threads in it, have to deburr it, then we have to let them one more visit to the annealing furnace, and then we'll assemble stuff, and then we'll ship it out. And then when the next customer brings in another design, they just had to flow it through a different pathway through the factory. And that's kind of neat, because they can make any design for anybody. So we started to wonder, why is it so costly? And we decided to go down to Maysville, Ohio, to see if it looked like this. And it didn't look like that at all. What they had done 15 years earlier is they took the two pathways through Pontiac that had the highest volume, and they took that sequence of machines up like a snake, and carefully took that sequence of machines and put it out in a long, straight line. And then they took the second most popular design and took that sequence and put that structure like a print. And then they built a plant around it. And what they were offering was very different than what they were offering in Pontiac. Those guys were saying, we can make any axle for anybody, just bring it here. And in Maysville, it was, we actually don't make anything for anybody. But if you have a design that we can build by following one of these two sequences of activities, boy, we can do this at low cost and very high quality. And that's why they needed only $2.2 of overhead per direct in Ohio, and these guys needed 6.2 in Pontiac. And it really helped us understand what was going on. Now, if I got my eraser and I took away the names of those machines, and I asked you, does this diagram represent a hospital or an axle factory? What would you say? It's exactly the same thing. And the reason is exactly the same reason, and that is this plant, their purpose is to make anything for anybody, as is a general hospital. And as a result of that, they're very costly and very capital and overhead intensive. And as we try to build upon the best we can with our hospitals, they truly have become not just complicated, but they're impossible. And it looks to me like if I were asked to become the CEO of a hospital, I'd think about it, to become responsible for something that can't succeed. And there are, part of the problem with the complexity is there are three fundamentally different business models in the world, and we're trying to do all of those fundamentally incompatible business models in the same organization. So the first type of business model that exists in a hospital, we call solution shops. And a solution shop is a business that tells you what the problems are and recommends solutions. And so there are consulting firms like McKinsey who are essentially solution shops. You pay them a ton of money, and they will come back to you and tell you what your problems are and how to solve them. The diagnostic and intuitive activities of hospitals are essentially solution shop businesses. And in a solution shop business, the only way you can make your revenue is a fee for service. Occasionally, Bain and Company, one of the big solution shops in business problems, have tried to cut deals with their clients to take some of their remuneration as a fee and have the rest be contingent upon are they successful implementing our recommendations. But they always have to back off because the results depend upon so many things besides the quality of their definition of the problems and recommendations, that business has to be done by fee-for-service. And so fee-for-service has a bad rap in the provider of care. And I think what we learned from this is, no, there is a situation in which the fee-for-service has to happen. And that's because we don't know what the result will be, and therefore we have to measure what the cost is. And there are a lot of businesses that make money on fee-for-service, and this is one of them. Just as an illustration of what a solution shop might look like, a friend of mine, Dave Snow, who until recently was the CEO of Medco, has suffered with asthma all his life. And it's been tough for him. He's seen dozens and dozens of specialists, and in his language, every one has added to, subtracted from, or multiplied the number of pills he was taking. At one point, he was spending more than $1,000 a month on his asthma, and nothing worked. And then he read an early piece that we wrote about solution shops, and he realized shortly after that there's an organization in Denver called the National Jewish Medical Center. And it's organized as a solution shop for pulmonary and respiratory diseases. In other words, their business is to define the problem and recommend the solution. And it turns out that asthma isn't a disease, as you probably know. That wheezing is a symptom that is shared by somewhere between 7 and 10 diseases. And you can't give somebody a predictable solution unless you know which type of asthma you have. So Dave decided to go out and test it. He walked in, and on the first day, they administered a standard body of tests. And then on the second day, they stuck him in a room with a table, and in walked four specialists, and they sat down and immediately started to argue with each other about what the data really meant, asked each other questions, looked at more data, asked Dave questions, looked at more data, argued some more. And after about 30 minutes, the leader of the group stopped and said, "Dave, I think we got it. The reason why you haven't been responsive to any of those drugs is you don't have one of those types of asthma. You have this type, and it's your lucky day. There's just a simple generic drug that's going to solve the problem." So we want to keep you here for one more day just to be sure. We're going to stress test your body, but we're quite certain that that will solve the problem, and it did. So when Dave was going back to New Jersey, he had a couple of questions. He said, you know, I have seen every one of those specialists many times in my career, but I always had met with them alone. And this is the first place where I could hear them integrate together their perspectives. Why is that? And the answer, obviously, was if you tried to get partners in Boston to coordinate a meeting with four specialists, you'd have to organize this 6 months in advance. And these guys, because they're organized around a different business model, it was a everyday occurrence to be able to pull people off to come together and get a perspective on the disease that nobody else could do. And the second question Dave asked himself was it cheap or expensive for me to fly to Denver, meet with the time of four specialists, and then go back home again? Ladies and gentlemen, it was dirt cheap, because he had spent how many jillions of dollars and how many jillions of wasted days in the pursuit of a solution to a problem that was misdiagnosed. So that's one solution shop, is a business that exists inside of most hospitals, but very few hospitals are organized to run that as a successful business. Mayo does it by instinct in Rochester, but there are not many. There's not a solution shop in America for type 2 diabetes, for example, a horrible disease. Type 2 isn't a disease, it's a symptom. And there are somewhere between 12 and 22 different diseases that share the same symptom of elevated levels of glucose. But there's no place you can go to find out what type of type 2 we have. And so most type 2s are taking medicines that aren't appropriate for their disease. Now, the second type of a business model in a hospital, we call a process business. And a process business is one where you take stuff in that's incomplete or broken, and you do stuff to it, and then you ship it at the other end. So most manufacturing, of course, is done in a process business context, but education is a process business. Every year at the Harvard Business School, we bring in 900 very complete and somewhat broken people. And we do stuff to them every day for 2 years, and then we ship them perfected to Wall Street. And you can predict in advance what the cost of this is going to be, and so we can ask them to pay for the outcome, not for the input. And this is why fee-for-service creates such trouble, as we try to make money in a process business in the same way we do in a solution shop business. And they are fundamentally different businesses. And you see solution shop, or you see process businesses emerge almost, you can't keep them down. So in the Boston area, there's an orthopedic center called New England Baptist Hospital. And essentially, they stopped taking patients in anything else except orthopedics. And because that's what their focus is, boy, are they efficient, like Maysville, Ohio. The operation cost is similar, but the overhead cost is much less. And so you can do it in Boston at New England Baptist at about 45% lower cost than you can do it in Mass General Hospital because of the overhead. Those of you who are interested, north of Toronto is the Shoulders Hospital, all they do there is hernia surgery. And they could do it at 60% lower cost for hernia repair. And it's actually like a golf club. It's a nice place to go. And then the third type, we call a facilitated network. And these are primarily businesses where people interact with each other, and whoever orchestrates or the network are the people that make the money. You have to pay a fee for membership. And so telecoms is a facilitated network. And most of us begin to realize that the care of chronic diseases like D-Life for type 1 diabetes or Crohn's.org are organizations where the patients teach care of each other and teach each other how to deal with their diseases. And it's actually a better business model for chronic disease than hospitals are or doctors' offices. And so if you got offered to be a CEO of a hospital, think about it this way. Imagine that you took McKinsey and merged it with the Whirlpool manufacturing operations and then merged with Northwestern Mutual Life. And you say, this is your business. And we want you to report your financial results on the same integrated statement and measure things in the same way. It's just impossible to do. So for those of you who work in hospitals or run hospitals, I pray for you. Now, a way to solve it, of course, is to create three hospitals, not one. And we probably need a few integrated places where the really complicated people can go. But for most of us, we could be cared for at much lower cost. Now, I want to go to the second of the big blocks, which is what I call the managed care of managed care. You can describe the history of almost every industry as a set of concentric circles. And each of these represents populations of people. The population in the centermost circle represent customers in a market who have the most money. And then as you go to the larger circles, they represent larger populations of customers who have progressively less and less money until you come to the periphery where you and I live our lives. And almost always, industries begin at the center because the first products and services are so costly that only the rich have access to them. So just by a simple illustration, before I do that, I'll tell you the model and then talk about illustrations of it. So think about a business that's organizing itself in the centermost circle. And in every industry, this model describes what happens. In every market, there is a trajectory of improvement that providers offer their customers. And that's their ability to provide improvement. In every market, there's a different trajectory of improvement that customers are able to utilize. And you see that the ability to provide improvement goes up faster than the ability of customers to use the improvement. So that on the left-hand side, the first products aren't good enough to deliver what customers need. And then on the right-hand side, they overshoot what they need. And a good way to visualize this is go back to the mid-1960s when we were first learning to do word processing on those early personal computers. Do you remember how crummy those computers were? And about every 30 seconds, you had to stop your fingers to let the Intel 286 chip catch up. Because the world's fastest chip couldn't keep pace with our fingers. But as Intel kept introducing faster and faster chips, if you open your laptop today, you only use about 15% of the capacity of the processor inside. Intel has way overshot what most customers are able to utilize. In my business, higher education, on the left-hand side, when online learning first began to emerge, we at Harvard would look down our noses at online teachers and say, not as good as Harvard. And that was the right answer to the wrong question. And the right question is the technology improving at a rate that people who are not as good as us today could actually overshoot what we can do tomorrow? And if any of you have taken any online courses recently, oh my gosh, it's just extraordinary what they can do. And plain old ordinary professors can't improve that fast. Now, innovations that allow companies to come to the market with better and better products, we call sustaining innovations. Almost all innovation in healthcare has been sustaining in character. We try to make good products better that we could sell for higher prices to our best customers. But there is a different type of technology that we call disruptive innovation. And disruptive innovation transforms things that are complicated and expensive into things that are so much more affordable and accessible that many more people have access to it. And these kinds of disruptive innovations are what brings costs down in an industry. Sustaining innovations drive costs up. So, for example, in computing, a mainframe computer cost $2 million, and their gross margins were $1,200,000. There was a disruptive innovation emerged in the industry in the 1970s that we called mini mills. And a mini mill was a cabinet that only cost $200,000 rather than $2 million. And it made it so affordable and accessible that engineers could now have a computer in their department. But they only offered gross margins of $90,000 rather than $1.2 million. And so all the companies that made mainframe computers spent the rest of their lives making bigger and better mainframes. Because to go down and make a simple little mini computer made no economic sense. And those were all new companies that introduced mini computers to the market. And ultimately, the mainframe companies all got killed. Then the next one was the personal computer. And if you remember, they cost about $2,000, not $200,000, gross margins in $700,000 rather than $90,000. And the personal computer made it so affordable that you and I could have a computer. And we could only do simple things at the beginning, but my gosh, as the computer got better and better, plain old ordinary people like you and I can start to do pretty sophisticated things. And a huge new market emerged. The companies that made the mini computers, however, spent the rest of their lives making bigger and better mini computers because to go down into a simple thing made no economic sense. These were all new companies that came out from the bottom, and we call them Dell, Lenovo, Hewlett-Packard, Compaq, and so on. And then the next wave has been the smartphone, which cost $200 rather than $2,000, not much margin on it at all. But a whole new population of people now have computers and use them, and oh my gosh, they are improving at a stunning rate. So that now there are a lot of people who don't buy personal computers anymore, because the smartphone can do almost everything that they're trying to do. And as happened in the past, the companies that were the leaders in personal computers aren't making smartphones. So Hewlett-Packard, they're not there. Dell is not there. Lenovo is not there. But these are all new companies. So the rule is that in sustaining innovations, the leaders in the industry always win. And when disruption occurs, making things affordable and accessible, the entrants win. So why should you be interested in this? Where is the Minute Clinic on this chart? They're making it affordable and accessible so that a larger population of people for whom healthcare is a very expensive proposition, by making it affordable and accessible, many more people have access to it. And we, operating general hospitals in the center, look down our noses and say, these guys aren't as good as our hospital, which is the right answer to the wrong question. And we'll get into a little bit more of this, but this is the theory of disruption, and this is the mechanism by which healthcare, like every products in every other industry, become affordable and accessible. It's not by expecting that the people in the center will become cheap, but rather they have to be displaced with lower cost providers. Now, I want to talk about organization a little bit. And this is the way to frame when does the structure of an industry have to change and when is it going to be okay. So here, what I'm trying to describe again is the intersection between this, the rate at which technology improves versus our ability of customers to utilize the improvement. At the beginning of almost every industry, the problems are such that you have to be integrated in order to play in the game. And the reason why you have to be integrated is that the interdependency between the components in the system depend upon everything else. You make a change in any component, you have to change the design of all of the other components, and I'm trying to depict that with the puzzle pieces there. It means that you have to do everything in order to do anything. And in the history of the smartphone business, Nokia and the BlackBerry from RIM had excruciatingly interdependent architectures. And at the beginning of every industry, it has to be that way, because you can't figure out how the pieces snip together in a clear way. But when the product becomes more than good enough on the right-hand side, how do you compete when you overshoot what customers need? And the answer is that little by little, the way you compete changes. Rather than making better and better products, you compete by making products that are fast and responsible and customized and accessible. And in order to compete in that way, the architecture moves from interdependent and proprietary to open and modular. And you see that happening now in the smartphones. The Android operating system is consummately modular, and that's Samsung, and a jillion other suppliers of smartphones in China. And the technology is good enough that you can now dictate how the pieces fit together. And that allows you to make much lower cost products. And so the reality is that the strategy depends upon where you are. And Apple, and the iPhone were proprietary products. And it was a great ride, but now as the market is shifting, poor Apple is in real trouble. On the left-hand side, the way you have to manage a corporation is what we would call the visible hand of managerial capitalism. And on the right-hand side, it is the invisible hand of Adam Smith's capitalism. So those of you who are nerds and read a book called The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith in 1776, he had this vision of capitalism in his mind. And in that vision, there was a clear price for every product being sold in a market. And that price was fair. And so if over here it was growing and this it was shrinking in the industry, the invisible hand would allocate capital to whatever industries or sections of the industry were growing and took the capital away from those that are shrinking. And he described capitalism as a very efficient system. And it's guided by what he called the invisible hand of capitalism. Well, as time has passed, we've realized that there are some situations where the invisible hand doesn't work. And so if I want to do business with you, and we want to deal with each other on an arm's length basis, there are three conditions that have to be met in order to deal with each other in a way that Adam Smith envisioned. First, I need to tell you exactly the specifications that you have to provide to me so that it will work in my system. So I have to be able to specify what you have to deliver. Number two, there has to be a way for me to measure what I asked you to deliver. And number three, and most importantly, there cannot be any unpredictable interdependencies between your piece and my piece. Because if you do something different and I put it into my system and it doesn't work, that creates all kinds of trouble. And so if you meet these three conditions, I can specify, I can measure, and there are no unpredictable interdependencies, we can deal with each other like Adam Smith, two different companies focused on our two different things. In this diagram, we call it a modular system, where you don't have to be integrated to play in the game. But if you're in the other situation where I actually don't know how to specify what I want you to do for me, or I can't measure what I need you to deliver, or holy cow, if you change anything in the way you're doing your work, I'm afraid that it'll change the way I do my work, then I cannot deal with you in an arm's length basis, and you have to do instead what we call the visible hand of capitalism. A good two examples of that are when Henry Ford started to make his Model T, the steel that he could get from Carnegie Steel was variable. He'd push it into a die to transform a flat piece of steel into a fender. And unpredictably, some of the steel would rebound 2%, some would rebound 7%. And so the dimensions of his fenders varied by 5%. And Carnegie couldn't put their arms around that problem. And so Ford had to build their own steel mill. And putting their arms around the whole problem, they could solve it. As independent players, they could not. And where I think healthcare is right now, is we're in a realm where we need the visible hand of managerial capitalism. Because the three conditions required for you to be independent of me makes it very hard and very complicated and adds a lot of cost to the system. Whereas the visible hand allows you to make decisions that are optimized for the system, not for my individual peace. So let me just give you a couple of illustrations of what we mean by the visible hand. Just imagine that Harvard decided to sell its courses on a course-by-course basis to the students. Okay, just imagine we wanted to do this. Well, we have to put a price on the course. And how are we going to price the course? Because it should represent the cost of producing the course, but it also should represent the value of the course to the customer, okay? So fine, how should we price English Literature 435? Seriously, how do we price this? Well, if we have good accountants, we can estimate to some degree of preciseness the cost of putting the course out, but what's the value of English Literature 435? Well, it's different for every customer, right? So it's complicated. And what would make it worse is what would happen if Yale decided to sell their courses on a course-by-course basis? Whose price is better? Well, it depends upon the value. Well, what's the value? Well, you can't measure that, you know? And how are we going to price Chemistry 311, for goodness sakes? Because you got all of this allocated coming from the labs and so on. And so what the universities have done is, ladies and gentlemen, we actually can't put a price on a course because their value depends upon so many things, their prerequisites and postrequisites and things you have to take in common and their reputation. And Harvard, of course, is better than Yale, but is Yale better than who knows? And so the universities say, guys, what the heck? Would you just pay tuition? And we'll take a fee from you every year. And then if you want to get drunk every day and never go to class, it's your choice, you know? And you want to take twice the number of courses, it's your choice. But because the conditions don't exist, there's not a price, I can't specify, there's so many interdependencies, to try to deal with the university on a course-by-course basis would just be horrific. Well, as you can see, Clay's view is, I'm a physician, a patient comes in, and I say, man, I think we ought to take this test. But darn it, the cost of that test is about $4,000. Maybe we should, maybe we shouldn't. You know, and because of reimbursement, we have to have a price on every test, every procedure, every consult, every use of whatever. And it makes the world very costly. Because we try to get reimbursed, we have to get a price. Where did the prices come from? So just imagine, how are we going to price English Literature 435 in a hospital? How you define the? How do you put a price on the cost of a test? Well, I think what they do is somewhere in Silver Springs, in a basement, there is a machine that is a random number generator. And there's a whole industry that has emerged taking random numbers and trying to make them to reflect reality. But this is a very complicated problem. And if you look underneath the machine, it says, made in the Kremlin in the 1940s. And the communists decided it wasn't an accurate machine. But the reason for it is we have a reimbursement system. And especially for the business model that is a process business model, this system is just crazy. And making a crazy system more efficient isn't nearly as productive as just fundamentally changing. And it requires managerial capitalism, meaning people who put together the right things with the right things. My sense is that reimbursement as a business will need to go away, except for solution shop businesses where it's actually critical. But that's why I say that if we don't solve this problem that we're organized in the wrong way, we're trying to offer healthcare in the invisible hand of perfect competition. It's the wrong way to organize, and therefore everything else that we do is going to be hard. How do we disrupt healthcare? Well, do I think that hospitals will become cheap? I might pray and fast every weekend for the rest of my life, hoping that the expensive ones will become cheap. And it tests my faith. But what I think real is plausible is that we need to bring technology so that outpatient clinics can start to do the things that historically we had to address in a hospital. And then we need to drive technology into the clinic so that it can do more and more sophisticated things, so that we have to use the hospital less and less. And then we need to bring technology to doctors' offices and retail clinics, so you can do there the simplest of the things that today we have to address in a clinic. But then we have to keep driving technology so that those new venues of care can do more sophisticated things, ultimately bringing technology to doctors' homes or to the patients' homes so they can do things that historically the specialists had to deliver. And those of you who are dealing with dialysis know that, gosh, there are technology now that I can just do it at home. And by making it affordable and accessible, we're all better off. And in a similar way, rather than hoping that the specialists will take pay cuts, I had to bring technology to the personal care physicians so they can start to do the simplest of the things that today they feel obligated to send on to a specialist. But then we have to keep driving technology into her practice so she can do more sophisticated things. And in a similar way, nurse practitioners and pharmacists, so that they can do more sophisticated things, and the family care providers can do more sophisticated things. So if there's something that I want you to remember out of this talk, it would be three. One, we need to fundamentally address the problem that there are different business models required for different value propositions to the customer. And a single one-size-fits-none offering that we can do everything for everybody at every facility creates problems for us. So that's the first one. The second one is we need management, because the market can't deal with the interdependencies from all of the providers. And then the third one is we need to disrupt the industry. And so we need to bring technology so that lower cost caregivers and lower cost venues of care can do more sophisticated things. And that's the mechanism by which we can help healthcare to become affordable and accessible. Now, this is my sense for what to worry about this problem. That is, I think about 90% of America is being serviced by companies that are like Adam Smith, independent providers of their piece of the system. And so there are hospitals, there are clinics, there are independent physicians, practices, there's the Minute Clinic, there are insurance providers that underwrite this stuff, and they all do their own piece of the system. And it's not the right system for most of healthcare. The way those guys, what their incentives are if I'm at a hospital at Partners, I'm incentivized to go out and buy all of those guys to try to pull their volume into the hospital because I need to keep my beds full. And my sense is that I'll call it individual capitalism or Adam Smith capitalism, is organized to keep the old system in their throne for a very long time. The other system, which I will characterize as managed capitalism, or the visible hand, are providers like Intermountain and some of the Geisinger and Kaiser Permanente, where they've taken the reimbursement system and brought it in-house. And essentially, just like the universities, they pay tuition. Here's a fixed cost. And the nice thing about that kind of a system is they make money by keeping people healthy, as opposed to the other system where they make money when people get sick. And it's a reason why this is a very important thing for us to address, is if we don't change fundamentally that model so that care starts to be provided by those who make money by keeping people healthy, we just keep running on with our problems. And that's what I'm trying to describe on the right-hand side, that their managerial capitalism tries to drive the delivery of care to caregivers that can provide the right amount of care. So there we are. I'm glad that you are in the positions that you're in, not me. If you find that this is too hard for you, my recommendation is that you should quit and come to Harvard and become a professor like me. Because in my position, all I have to do is talk, and you guys have to do, which is a nice profession for me. But I really do believe that if we go back in the history of literally every industry, they went through this transition in one way or another. They started out with complicated, expensive products that were available only to the rich. And then they went through this kind of a transition that we call disruption. And now they offer products and services that are so much more affordable and accessible that many more people have access to the very best. And I believe that will happen in healthcare. The result of making it affordable and accessible is actually many more people will consume healthcare. And you might view these things as a threat. In reality, it is a great opportunity for all of us. But in order to take advantage of that, we have to be able to realize that a business model has to change, the reimbursement has to change, except for solution shops. We need solution shops because we need to define the problem, and so on. So we interviewed a physician in our area named Gordon Williams, who is a tenured professor at the Harvard Medical School, who has really become kind of the person in the world in endocrinology and hypertension. And we studied and interviewed him to understand how he had done such remarkable work in his field. And he said, the problem with medicine research is they're obsessed with data. And they think that if they have an N in their study of 20,000 patients, it's a better result than if you have 2,000 patients and so on, because the P's are better and the R squareds are better and so on. He said, but in the end, they can only show us what's correlated with what. And he said, I think all of my research has been with an N of one. And the reason is, those guys are studying symptoms. I want to understand the disease. And diseases exist in a patient as a set of processes. And these processes intersect with each other in various places in the body. And you can't understand the processes of a disease if you're trying to study simultaneously 20,000 patients. You can only see it by study in an N of one. And then he said, in the end, I'm trying to understand, I'm not trying to understand the patient, I'm trying to understand the disease. Because if I understand the disease, then when a patient presents himself to me, I don't ask, there's a 60% probability that this is your problem. Because I don't want to talk to a patient as a member of a population. When the patient comes, I want to be able to say, you have this disease, or you don't have that disease, you have this disease. Because if I can define their disease and not their symptom, I can predictably provide care to them in a predictable way. And this is the way people who are lower cost people can do progressively more sophisticated things if we try to understand the diseases, not the analytics of big data. So I hope that also might be useful for some of you. And I agree with Gordon that we spend a lot of money on symptoms, not enough on understanding the disease. And if we did that and had solution shops, we would be better off.